Hi, my name is Berna. This is my second year in the Girls Right Now program. This piece is a stream of consciousness titled Chocolate-Covered Pomegranates. Sometimes I wonder about this writing thing, how permanent it is, how worthwhile. Sometimes I don't see it going very far, and sometimes I can see galaxies, streaks and studs of brightness spilled over my ceiling while I try to fall asleep. There are roughly 7 trillion stars in the observable universe, 100 million in the Milky Way. But to the tiny little human standing on the surface of your tiny little planet in your tiny little corner of the universe, only about 5,000 stars can be seen by your average eye. And even still, you only see 2,500. Light travels the expanse of the universe to reach my eyes, and I write about how you touch the rosary hanging from your rearview mirror before you drive me anywhere to reach yours. Sometimes I feel so in love with the idea of being a writer, and so in love with words and how a person becomes powerful when they know how to use them correctly. I see 7 trillion stars. Sometimes I feel so insecure. I ask myself, what if you run out of things to write about? What then? 2,500. When my father says dream big, he means dream of money, dream of stability, of big cars and big houses. Dream bigger than we did. Children are supposed to exceed their parents, Berna, my mother says. My father says that he will buy a nice big car for the daughter who becomes a doctor. And then my mother would say, make sure they get a good job so they can buy a car themselves. And then she would talk about bills and rent and independence, and that's when the insecurity creeps into me, and then my dreams are changing again. But I always come back to writing, to pour out thoughts and tapping my keyboard frantically in the middle of the night. And that has to mean something. I know the business of being a writer is risky. My family doesn't know how to support something crazy like that. You can become a pharmacist, like Oswin, my mother said to me, while I was getting checked up. I didn't know how that was relevant to the blood pressure band getting too tight around my arm, but it seemed like she had been worrying about me lately, more so than usual. I told you, Mama, I don't want to do medicine. Then what do you want to do? I don't tell her. I don't think that my parents are trying to dream for me. They're just worried, because they're parents, and no parents wants to see their children struggle. I just think that it's all they know. Doctor, engineer, those are the only two options back in Goa. And I guess that's why my parents came to America, to give me more options, opportunity. And that's why my dad's hands are cracking and my mother's always praying. And just for them, sometimes I think about pursuing something practical, so I can buy myself that car. But I don't like medicine, I don't like math, I don't like biology. It's interesting, but I don't have the common sense for it that everyone else in my family seems to have. And I don't want to be responsible for someone else's life when I can barely be responsible for mine. So the question is still this. What if you run out of things to write about? What then? I realize that the answer is, if I'm truly meant to be a writer, I will never run out of things to write about. Because I just don't have an obsession with writing, I have an obsession with the world. The people on the train, on the bus, the little girl talking and talking and talking to her father. And I wonder, when do we stop talking like that to our parents? So I write about it. And my mother coming home, tired and her hair frizzy like mine, but she still looks beautiful. I remember one day when she came home and I didn't open the door, and I didn't say, hi mama, how was your day? And she started to cry when I came into the kitchen, too late. Because she was tired, she missed her daughters, and I came into the kitchen. Hey, Mama, what's for dinner? She makes me lemon tea, cuts papaya for me, and she stays awake with me until I finish my homework, because I don't like leaving you alone. And someone needs to write about the day you realize your entire world is growing from your mother's feet. And my father, and him always saying you're just like me, our hands, our feet, our foreheads, the way our temper rests on the tip of our noses. The way we speak too fast and realize too late. Hey, Mama, what's for dinner? He's told me too many times, I drank my mother's milk for 3 years. The first time I saw Mama, she was sitting under a lamp, and I want to write about it for him. My dad sometimes tells me to write about him, and it surprises me every time, because he remembers that I write even when he doesn't pay attention to that part of me, even if he's never read anything that I've written. And once my mom told me that I looked like an author in my navy blue dress, a black cardigan slipped on top of it, a book hugged in my hand, while she was opening the door, and again, I was just surprised that she remembers. Or when I was searching for the journal that my mentor Jamie had given me because I lost it, or I was panicking and so close to crying even if I still couldn't write anything without my laptop. It had just been stuffed with ripped napkins and post-it notes that I had scribbled on to catch a lyric or a thought about how the rain sounded when I watered the houseplants my father kept on the windowsill. My journal, the one with the flowers on it. Oh, the one with the writing? Yeah, that one. So they're not trying to stop me, more like quietly push me forward, even though they're hesitant and scared, and my mom will probably try to pack the medical degree into my bags. Just in case, Berna. Why does it work like this? Why does something different get dropped into a place filled with a certain type of normal and screw everything up? Yesterday, my dad was lecturing us about the couch again. A chocolate-covered pomegranate had fallen into the cushions and melted all over the leather. When you grow up and buy things, you understand my pain. And he's pacing up and down, sweeping up the floor. It's past midnight already. If you want to sit on the couch, just sit on it, or don't. And then he stops and picks up a half-empty water bottle from the dining table. Berna, open this for me. I can't. He can't because he has band-aids wrapped around his fingers from picking the skin, like just like I do. I open it, sitting on the couch with this new displeasing chocolate stain, and then he pauses. You should learn how to take care of things. Every day I clean up this place. Pauses again. Berna, close this. He's holding the water bottle out to me again. I close it. And I write about it too. And I write this. After a week with a blocked mind, I write this in minutes. And that has to mean something.